The second lecture by
Professor the second? Your second
lecture. Oh
my God. I'm very sorry. The third lecture. Second day, but the third lecture. No, the third lecture by Christopher. Christopher, please.
Okay. So first of all, is there any question from what we discussed yesterday? Anything that you want to know more detail? Okay, so everything was clear, maybe. Totally confusing, I don't know. Okay, so...
Wait, I had one question.
Sure.
In fact, with those discussions about what you had about these pions and this effective Lagrangian coefficients A and B,
yeah.
In fact, those prefactor, which is exponent of something, is it not possible? It is possible in the standard model. It is possible when you go to unitary gauge, so you fix the gauge exactly with the same parameter as those pi, then to gauge out all these degrees of freedom.
Right.
So if you invent this additional coefficient A and B, why not possible to do the same and just, you know, anyway rotate out all this?
Well, I mean, if you work in the unitary gauge, no, I think you're referring to this Lagrangian that I was writing.
Yes.
Ray, sigma diamond, sigma. And then I was introducing some coupling, right?
Yeah.
Of the D, B, H squared.
And now for those waves,
so
gauge boson waves,
yeah,
in covariant derivatives. Why not to
so sigma, if you remember, was containing actually all the pions, right?
Yeah.
I, A, sigma, A. So what is happening is that in the unitary gauge, okay, you can rotate away this pi, but still you will have some covariant derivative here, right?
Yeah.
So this coupling A and B will be directly the coupling of the X to the W and the Z.
Right.
But this you cannot rotate away. They are physical.
That's for sure, yeah.
Right.
But pions you can rotate away.
Sure. Just a gauge choice. So clearly, if you go to the unitary gauge where sigma is equal to the identity,
yeah,
the pion disappears, but you have the longitudinal component of the W and the Z.
Well, but even if you go to those partly composite models,
yeah,
or something like that,
yeah,
why not to use same thing to rotate away those pions from a series? I don't know. Or is that not possible for what?
I didn't discuss the composite X model this afternoon, so
yeah,
there will be extra physical pions.
Yeah.
So in addition to this boson boson, that are equivalent to the longitudinal component of the W and Z, there will be extra Goldstone bosons that will remain physical in the spectrum, so not gauge away.
And they will be impossible to be, gauge out. Okay, we will come to this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that will be the case. So this model describes really the breaking of SO4 broken to SO3.
Yep.
So this produces the three Goldstone bosons that are the three pions. And that somehow are equivalent to the longitudinal component of the W and the Z. But what I will discuss this afternoon is some enlarged global symmetry like SO5 broken to SO4. SO5 is dimension 10, SO4 is dimension 6. So you expect four Goldstone bosons in this case. Three of them will be the pion here that I described. So this will become WL plus and minus ZL. And in addition, you will have four Goldstone bosons that you want to identify with X. So this, of course, you cannot rotate away.
Yeah.
Those ones, yes, you can rotate away, and I mean they're eaten by the X mechanism.
Okay.
But the physical X boson in this case will appear as a physical Goldstone boson. Okay, I'll discuss that this afternoon. Okay. So yesterday we mostly focused, on the classical theory. So I introduced this X potential and explained to you that the exchange of the X was there to unitarize W scattering. So that was giving you a consistent theory when you are treating it at the classical level. So now we would like to see actually how much the quantum correction can change, you know, in particular, can change the shape of the potential. So is there any consistency condition that come actually from the study of this X potential at the quantum level? So if you remember, we wrote this, no, if you know it, we wrote this X potential in this form, right? So this famous Mexican hat potential, right? Has a shape, this, right? With an instability at the origin, and then a true minimum here was, let's say, H0, was B over square root of 2. And by expanding around the minimum here, something that we computed yesterday, we found that actually this potential is just contain a quadratic piece, which is just 2, just lambda of B squared, H squared, plus the term which is cubic and quartic in the X, right, with some coefficient that you can compute. You can do that in the exercise session if you want. So this certainly contains actually a mass term. So we computed that the X mass squared was equal to 2 lambda B squared. So in such a way that the two free parameters that you introduce in your Lagrangian, in the X potential, namely lambda and B, are actually fixed by some experimentally measured quantity. So the first one is the mass of the Higgs boson, and the second is just the Fermi constant, you know, that was controlling the beta decay or the muon decay. You know? And this is, I think, given by square root of 2 V squared. Right? Because this is related, you remember that we, by doing the matching with the exchange of the W, we were able to obtain the relation like this. It's controlling mass of the W up to some numerical factor, right? And this is nothing else than V squared. So the ratio of the gauge coupling square divided by the mass of the W is indeed the value of the Higgs boson.
Christoph, that's a great relation, because it relates G Fermi, which was measured long ago,
yes,
before vacuum expectation value was even invented, right?
Yes, yes. And the thing that you have to remember also here is that V actually is equivalent to a coupling squared, or is the inverse of a coupling. Right? So sometimes, you know, you see that V is just a scale or energy scale, but V is actually a coupling. And that was kind of obvious, you know, when we looked at WW scattering in the absence of the Higgs boson. You know, if you remember, we found an expression for the scattering amplitude that was S divided by V squared. So you should ask yourself, so where is the coupling in this relation? I have a scattering, I have no coupling, no gauge coupling or anything. Well, you have a coupling because V is actually equivalent to V coupling, which is obviously G Fermi was a 4 Fermi interaction, so it really controls an interaction of all particles. And again, that's something that you can understand by looking at the h-bar dimension, as I mentioned yesterday, right? So h-bar is really counting the power of the coupling. Okay, so that's a classical level picture. Now we would like to see actually how the quantum correction can change this potential, right? So first I will focus on the correction, let's say, to the quartic coupling. So the coupling, the correction to lambda that goes like h to the 4. And then in the second part of the lecture, we'll discuss actually the correction to the quadratic term. So when you expand, you have a quartic and a quadratic term plus a constant. Okay, the constant, we never care because this is just a cosmological constant. And, you know, as long as you don't introduce gravity, the cosmological constant, you can always throw it away. It's not a problem for particle physics. So, what is a quantum correction to the quartic coupling? So, I would like to keep this expression. That's an important one. So, what do I mean by quantum correction? Well, you simply want to look at the one loop correction to this quartic interaction. So, at classical level, you simply have an interaction. I should draw some dashed line for the scalars. That would be important. So, that's quartic interaction, and now you have to draw some one-loop diagram that can give some correction to this quantity. Then you want to compute those diagrams. So what are the diagrams that will also correspond, a one-loop diagram that will give you a correction to this quartic interaction?
Fish.
How do you draw a fish? Like this?
Yeah.
That's a fish?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, that's certainly true. However, this diagram is only logarithmically divergent. So that's not the most important one, right? Because one propagator of a scalar field is 1 over p squared. So you have two propagators, 1 over p squared. So when you are doing the integral of the momentum, you have d4p, 1 over p to the 4. And this integral is only logarithmically divergent. So the claim is that there are actually other diagrams that are more important, namely that they are more divergent than this one. So that's really the one that I want to focus on. So yes, you're right, this is a correction, but this is sublinear. I was confusing with the correction to the mass. Yeah, no, you're probably right, actually. You're right, sorry.
For the
quartic, this is an important correction. Yeah, the correction to the quartic is only logarithmically divergent. The quadratically divergent contributions are for the mass steps. Okay, so there is this one. What are the other corrections? So in the standard model, so certainly you have the scalar field, but you have also other fields at your disposal. And you can couple the Higgs to the fermion and to the gauge boson. And those will also give you some correction to the quartic interactions.
And what about three scalar derivatives?
Free scalar is appearing after electric symmetry breaking. Right? So here we'll compute the correction, let's say, to the unbroken phase. In this case, there is no three-point vertex. It's only four points. Okay, so that was the first one. Okay, interaction with the gauge boson. We have these things. And you have a loop box of fermions. So again, those diagrams should be quadratically divergent. So let's say here you have four propagators of fermions, right? The continuous line is a fermion, so each of the momentum like goes like 1 over p. So again, when you're doing the momentum integral, you will find d4p times 1 over p to the 4. So this is again logarithmically divergent.
Christopher, maybe it makes sense to mention that here only irreducible diagrams play a role.
Yes, there will be
irreducible diagrams.
Yes, there will also some wave function renormalization. Mm-hmm. Here, look only at the 1pi diagrams. And what about this diagram? So here, the propagator is 1 over p squared. So again, I have four propagator. Right? But you have to remember that the interaction between is this logarithmically divergent or not? That should be fine.
Yeah, because you have dU p nu over m squared, so it propagates.
Yes. Oh. So I think I should put another scalar here.
Yeah. Always.
And in this case, Yeah, in this case, it is actually logarithmically divergent because this interaction between two scalars and one gauge boson involve one derivative. Right? If you remember, this interaction are coming from d mu h squared. Right? D mu h is just d mu h plus I j a mu h squared. So if you want to keep two, let's say two scalar field and one gauge boson, you need to take the cross term. And this cross term involves one derivative. So this means that here a price which is a multiplication by P. Okay. So again, at the end of the day, you end up with a logarithmic divergence for all these diagrams. Okay. So you can compute those diagrams, at least the logarithmically divergent pieces, and this gives you simply the one-loop renormalization group evolution for the evolution of this coupling as a function of the energy. So you are dealing with quantum field theory, so all the couplings are actually function of the energy, so the energy of the particles. So at the end of the day, if you compute those diagrams, you will find this simple differential equation, d log over d lambda over d log of q, q being the energy of the process. So here you find the contribution which is quadratic in the in lambda, and then you compute simply this particular coefficient, this numerical coefficient in front of it, turns out to be 24. So here you have a contribution which is proportional to the fourth power of the Yukawa interaction. So this will be minus 6 y top to the 4. So here we consider only the top Yukawa because this is the largest contribution, the largest Yukawa interaction. The coupling of the X to the fermion is proportional to the mass. So the only really relevant diagrams here involves the top quark. And here I have the contribution that involves the different fermions and different gauge boson. And this gives you the contribution which is 3 over 8 g prime to the 4 plus 3 quarter g prime squared g squared plus 9 over 8 g to the g to the 4. And in addition, indeed, due to the wave function renormalization, you have actually other contributions, which is mixing lambda, the Yukawa interaction, and the gauge coupling. And those turns out to be the following, minus 3 g prime squared plus 9 g squared minus 12 top Yukawa squared times lambda. So this is coming simply from the wave function renormalization of the X. So now, the game is actually to solve this differential equation, and this will give you actually the evolution of lambda as a function of the energy. So you have the initial condition. Let's say that lambda at the weak scale, so lambda at the scale Q, which is of the order V, should be related to the mass of the X by this relation. And now what we are interested in is actually how lambda really evolve with the energy, what is the high energy behavior of lambda. So for that, you can actually solve this differential equation in two different regimes. So we make some approximation because at the end of the day, it's a too complicated equation, at least for me. So we first solve in the limit where the mass of the X is very large, mH large. And mH large means actually that lambda is large. And how large it is? So it should be in the limit where actually the dominant contribution from the right-hand side is actually coming from the XF interaction. So that will be the first limit. And the second limit is small lambda, small mH. And in this case, the dominant contribution from the right-hand side is actually due to the top-upper interaction itself. When lambda is small, so this is small, and the top-upper is a number for the 1, while the gauge coupling are number for the 0.2, 0.3. So they are smaller than the upper interaction. So you can find an approximate solution by keeping only the top-upper. So let me first solve this differential equation in the large X mass regime, so 16 pi squared d lambda over d log q should be equal to 24 lambda squared. So then it's getting a simple equation that you can solve on the blackboard, on the whiteboard. You say that d lambda over lambda squared is equal to 3 over 2 pi squared d log q, and this is 1 over lambda minus 1 over lambda plus 1 over lambda at an energy q equal q naught equal 3 over 2 pi squared log of q minus q naught. Something that you can rewrite as 1 over lambda is equal to 1 over lambda 0 minus 3 over 2 pi squared log of q over q naught. So what do you notice here first? Is that here you have a positive sign, right? So this means that if you start with a large value of lambda at the width scale, you are trying to see how the things evolve with the energy. Since the sign is positive, lambda will increase with the energy. So you start with a large number, and this number will become even larger. So you have a sort of instability in this equation. Okay, and it is an instability because at some point, you know, we'll get something that really blows up. So here you really you end up with a lambda pole. You know, for finite energy, it's the energy at which lambda really becomes infinite. So lambda goes to infinity at an energy q, which is the solution of this equal to 0, right? So 1 over lambda naught is equal to 3 over 2 pi squared log of q lambda pole by q naught. So this is telling you that ql, the lambda pole, is q naught exponential of 2 pi squared divided by 3 divided by lambda 0. And now you can use your initial condition, right? That the mass of the x squared is twice lambda 0 v squared at q naught equal v. So this is equal v exponential 2 pi squared divided by 3, and lambda 0, you replace it by mh squared. Two times four and d squared. Okay. So the evolution in this case looks like this. So you start with q. So you start at v with an initial condition for lambda zero, which is 2 mh. Squared divided by 2 v0 squared, and then you end up a singularity with evolution at q left, at q lambda, q lambda pole, at finite energy. So this means certainly, you know, that if lambda is infinite, I mean, the system doesn't make sense anymore. So this means that certainly you need to introduce new physics at an energy below q left in order to modify the evolution of this system. So this means that in this case, you know, for this initial value of of lambda for this initial value of the mass of the Higgs, you have a maximum energy at which this this potential is actually actually makes sense. Sorry. So you get that lambda, you have a cutoff for the standard model, which has to be smaller than the position of this lambda 4, which is V exponential 4 pi squared V squared divided by 3 mH squared. So you first found, let's say, for a fixed value of mH, you found an upper bound on the scale at which you can really use the standard model. Alternatively, you know, if you say, well, I want to be able, you know, to use a standard model up to an energy lambda, this will give you actually an upper bound on the mass of the Higgs boson. So for fix mH, you get an upper bound on lambda, and conversely, for fix lambda, you get an upper bound on mH. And I will put you some, we will put some numbers into this equation in a moment. Of course, I mean, you have to worry at some point that this analysis starts to make sense when lambda is becoming too large, right? Because here I've looked only at the one of correction. So this means that somehow it's an expansion in lambda. When lambda is becoming too large, you have also to consider the two-loop correction, the three-loop correction, that depends on higher power of lambda. So they could also modify, let's say, this, this simple one-loop renormalization analysis. But people have put that on the lattice, you know, when in principle you can really study strongly coupled regime, so you can really look at what is happening for very large value of lambda, and indeed they confirm that there exists a lambda pole at an energy which is close to the one that we derive here. This is an approximation, but this kind of makes sense even at the non-perturbative level. Okay? So that was the first limit, right? Then the second limit is small mH. Small mH means that small lambda, so the dominant piece in this case is coming from the Yukawa interaction. I need to solve the system, which is 16 pi squared, d lambda over d lambda over d log q, with minus 6 y top to the 4. And now, okay, you have a minus sign simply because you are dealing with a loop of fermions, right? And I don't know if you have already seen that in the quantum field theory lecture, but the loop of fermion always comes with an extra minus sign compared to the loop of a scalar field, right? A loop of a boson. So that explains why you have this minus sign. And now you see again that you are facing another sort of instability. So you start with a small value of lambda, and because of this minus sign, the evolution with the energy will drive you to even smaller value of lambda. Just the opposite case as before. So, how do you solve this equation? Well, in principle, you would say, well, this is a trivial equation, right? Except that now, you still don't know actually what is the dependence on the Tokugawa with the energy. So, this is not a closed system, right? Just before, you had a simple differential equation that you could solve directly. Now, you cannot do that because this is still an unknown function of the energy. So this means that you need to solve at the same time another renormalization group evolution that is controlling actually the evolution of the Tokugawa coupling. And in this case, okay, the Tokugawa coupling is simply an interaction with two top quarks and one Higgs boson. So this is a three-level diagram. And now at one loop, you will have something. It's one loop correction to the top Yukawa coupling. And this again you can compute, and this is also logarithmically divergent. And this gives you, in this case, the evolution of the top Yukawa coupling. So 16 pi squared dy top over d log q, in this case, is equal to 9 over 2 times y top q.
Plus again, some contribution are proportional to smaller Yukawa interactions. That's that you can neglect. So now you really have a system of two differential equations that are coupled to each other. You need to solve those two, this system, to know both the evolution of the top Yukawa and the evolution of lambda with the energy. Still, this is a system which is simple enough that I can solve it on the whiteboard. Okay? So let's see here. I got a dy top over y top q. Okay? So y top q is 1, 2, and 3. Right? So this is 9 over 32 pi squared log q. This is minus 1/2, minus 1/2 y top squared minus y top at q naught equals 0, q naught squared, 9 over 32 pi squared log q divided by q. Okay? Okay, and so now you can inject actually this solution into this second differential equation. Instead of doing that, I will do another trick. Okay. I will just take the ratio of this differential equation and get the d lambda over d y top is equal to minus 6 and 2 is 12 divided by 9. So it's 4/3 y top. So since the top Yukawa is a simple equation, a simple function of the energy, you get now that lambda becomes a simple function of the top Yukawa. You exchange the energy for the Yukawa introduction. So you can solve this equation, which is telling you that lambda minus lambda naught should be equal to minus 4/3 y top squared minus y top 0. Okay. And now, what will happen is that y top is increasing with the energy, right? So this will increase with the energy. So at the end of the day, this second term here will become as large as the initial value of lambda zero, and you will end up, for some finite energy, you will end up with a value of lambda that becomes negative. The evolution with the energy, lambda. So again, you start with the initial condition, which is the same as before. Mh squared divided by 2 d0 squared for an energy which is of the order v. And at some point here, we end up with negative value of lambda. And this is bad, right? Because as soon as you have a negative value for lambda, it means that this potential, instead of going up for very large value of the field, now it will go down. So it means that the shape of the potential, will look like this for very large value of the field. So the true minimum of the potential won't be at finite energy anymore. This will be at most a metastable vacuum, but the true minimum will be pushed to infinity, to very large value of the X field. So certainly this cannot describe our universe. So we need to prevent this to happen. So certainly, again, you need to introduce new physics at an energy scale before the point where lambda becomes negative. So this is
don't know how to call it, Q instability, QI. It's another instability of things. And that's really the energy at which lambda becomes negative, or becomes zero. So this is given by the solution of this equation, which is lambda zero is equal to 4/3 of y top. Y top of Q instability squared minus Y top zero squared Q zero. Or is QI? And what is the initial value of the top you cover? So you can simply relate it to the mass of the top, which is the Yukawa interaction divided by square root of 2 times E. So you can really solve this equation. If you do it on the blackboard, you will make a mistake. You can do it here. And you found simply that QI is equal to V exponential 4 pi squared mh squared divided by y top 0 to the 4 divided by v squared. So again, for fixed value of the x mass, you know, you get an upper bound on the cutoff scale of the standard model. But conversely, for a fixed value of the cutoff, in this case, you get actually a lower bound on the mass of the X boson, simply because MH is now in the numerator. So you get a plot like this at the end of the day, right? So you get the diagram this form, so you plot, you know, as a function of the cutoff scale of the standard model, you plot the constraint on the value of the X mass. Okay. So I say that if the X mass is very large, you have this, what is called the triviality bound, right, that lambda becomes becomes infinite. So you are entering a non-perturbative regime. You cannot trust your standard model anymore. So that's what is called the triviality bound. And conversely, for small value of the X mass, then lambda becomes negative and you are ending up into this instability. So the electric vacuum becomes unstable. That's another equation like this is instability. Okay, so that's the shape of the phase diagram.
Christopher, it's extremely important plot. Maybe you spend 2-3 minutes more explaining explicitly how you plot this.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
From those plots, sure, that you have.
I mean, what I'm showing
is because they look very much different. So please explain it in more details. Okay.
Okay. I mean, what I'm showing on this plot
could
here.
Could you show first for that plot which you already, you see you have two curves.
Yes. Yes.
Maybe you can combine this first before you show us those which is presented in every textbook.
That's slightly different, right? Because this is the evolution of the quantic coupling of the H.
Yes.
So for fixed value of mH.
Yes.
That's the evolution of lambda as a function of the energy.
Yeah.
And here you see that there is a singularity which is appearing,
right,
where lambda becomes infinite.
Yeah.
And what this plot is showing you is that you need to introduce new physics at the scale lambda, which is below this instability region. So you get this bound. Right? The cutoff scale of the standard model as a function of the mass of the X boson.
Right.
And now here I'm exactly reporting this condition. Right? So as a function of lambda, I plot the value of mH that satisfies this condition. This is just the region below this curve. That's all what I'm doing.
Is it clear for everyone?
Yeah, some question, maybe, yeah, that's also...
Is it clear for everyone? Because that is
that's
a very crucial point for us, for the rest of the standard model.
Of course, at some point we will put, you know, the experimental data on this plot. So where, and what is the value of NH that has been measured, etc. Yes.
Is it really that higher radiative corrections destroy instability region?
I mean, the instability region is actually pretty safe because, you know, you're putting yourself into the limit of small MH. So it means small lambda. So you are really computing everything in a perturbative regime. Right? So you can really trust, let's say, the one loop correction. Of course, you will get small corrections due to two loop, three loop, etc. But that won't change the picture. The thing that was less clear is really about the triviality. Because I told you the triviality is when lambda becomes infinite. And when lambda becomes infinite, you cannot trust anymore the one loop computation. Right? Because you are really entering the non-perturbative regime. Nonetheless, as I said, I mean, people have looked at that on lattice, and they found a similar bound than the one that I derived here on the plot. Then you have to argue, you know, what is really the meaning of this line? Does it mean that lambda becomes infinite, which is not a physical quantity, or does it mean that lambda becomes equal to 4 pi or 16 pi squared or whatever? What is a perturbative definition, let's say, of a strongly interacting theory? So there is a little bit of uncertainty, you know, on this bound, depending on your right definition, let's say, of a strongly interacting theory where you lose perturbativity in your computation. But anyway, here, you know, since the scale are always logarithmic, doesn't really matter. Okay, so this is a picture. So now we are doing science, so we need to put numbers. We're doing physics, not mathematics. We need to put some numbers with some units. So the question is basically whether you can extend really the standard model, let's say, up to the Planck scale. So you know that anyway, the Planck scale, you need to change the standard model to include quantum gravity, etc., etc. So one of the questions is whether, you know, you need new physics at a scale below the Planck scale or not. So you want to see how it goes if you go up to 10 to the 19 GeV. Right? Is there first of all, is there a region here that is compatible with the two-bound, right? Or not? And here you will see, actually, if you put the numbers, I mean, in the equation that I've written here, that here for 10 to the 19 GeV, you will find something like 170 GeV. And here, we find something like 130 G. So if the X were between those two values, if the X mass were between those two values, indeed you could really extend the standard model up to the Planck scale without any theoretical inconsistency. Everything will have been totally consistent at the quantum level. You know, include all the quantum correction that you want in the X potential, you won't change really the picture. So now, of course, you all know that the experimental value that has been measured is actually 125 GeV with an accuracy which is below 1%. It's quite remarkable. You know, we really know the mass of the X actually to an accuracy which is 0.2%. Great achievement already. Given the fact that, you know, we haven't observed so many X's, right? And we have been able to reconstruct something like 100,000 X bosons at the end of the day. And most of them are not even in the most visible and most cleanest channel. So then, nonetheless, with those little number of events, you are able to put a good measurement of the X mass, and this is below actually this instability line. So the mass, the physical mass that has been observed, 125 GeV, doesn't allow you actually to really extend the standard model up to the Planck scale. So if you really insist on instability, you know, 125 will cross this instability line
at an energy scale which is 10 to the around 10 to the 11 GeV. Is it a problem or not? We don't know. Honestly, we don't know, because maybe the instability is a too strong requirement. You know, maybe there is indeed a local minimum, so maybe the shape of the potential is like that. So we are living in this electric vacuum. Maybe indeed the quantum correction will generate a true potential with a true minimum at infinity, but the tunneling time, you know, to go from the electric vacuum to the true minimum of the potential at infinity might be larger than the age of the universe. So that's what we call the metastability region. So it could be in an electric vacuum which is only metastable. And actually, it seems that it is indeed the case for 125. We are in an electric vacuum, which is only a local minimum of the potential, but the tunneling time from our electric vacuum to the true minimum at the quantum level is actually very large, and certainly larger than the edge of the universe. So we may be safe.
With a Planck scale?
Of course, I mean, everything depends, you know, crucially here, clearly, on the value of y top. One of the crucial quantities that really controls this instability or metastability region is the value of the top Yukawa, which is a precise measurement. You need a precise measurement of the mass of the top. And, you know, you have to understand that the top mass is something which is not so well defined. Depends if you include a lot of quantum correction to the top mass. I mean, how you, there is some non-perturbative contribution of the order of 100 MeV to the top mass due to some Renormalon effect that maybe Melnikov will tell you about. So I mean, QCD is always, you know, a very complicated system, non-perturbative effect can show up. So things are never really well defined in QCD. So that means that, you know, it's not that clear whether or not we are really in the metastability or instability, and you need to measure with good enough accuracy, you know, the top mass that really enter into this different flow equation. So whether, you know, it's MS bar mass, whether it's the pole mass of the top quark, all these things differ by a quantity which is affecting really this instability line. So the region between instability and metastability is a little bit fuzzy, not totally clear.
Which means that all those lines which you draw here should be taken with some error bar.
Absolutely. Right? So most likely, actually, here, you know, given taking into account, you know, the uncertainties in the definition of the top mass, you have at least, you know, a band. So it's not a line, but it's more like a band of the order 5 plus or minus 5 GeV. Nonetheless, you know, it certainly gives you some good motivation to measure very accurately not only the mass of the Higgs boson, but also the mass of the top quark. And that's something, you know, that you can do rather well, for instance, at a collider with E plus E minus. So you're producing, you know, you're using E plus E minus, you're producing a pair of top quark. And we are looking at close to the threshold, you get a close, very nice determination of the top mass. And from that, you can get back to the top Yukawa and check with this expression. So that's one main motivation that people are using sometimes, you know, to, let's say, to sell E plus E minus collider to really understand whether or not we are living in an electric vacuum, which is stable or metastable, and maybe to know whether our universe will decay at some point in the history of cosmology. Nonetheless, I don't really buy all this argument, because, you know, there will always be some important boundary condition that you need to take into account at the Planck scale. So here, you know, people are saying, well, you know, we just assume that, you know, we extend the standard model up to the Planck scale. And then, you know, there will be quantum gravity effect. But what is really, you know, the theory that you want to match on at the Planck scale. You know, exactly like when you are doing ground unification theory, you know, you can have a lot of threshold correction at the unification scale. And you can do that in a particular ground unified theory because you know exactly what is the unification theory, right? You know the gate group, so you know SU5, etc. So you can compute this threshold correction. Unfortunately, here, we cannot do the same because, okay, we know that we need to match with the quantum gravity theory, but we don't know any real consistent theory of quantum gravity. There is string theory, but okay, string theory is 10 to the 500 vacuum, right? So we don't know exactly what is this string theory. So you don't know exactly at, you know, what will be the matching between the standard model and the quantum gravity theory at the Planck scale. So this means that you are not able really to compute all this threshold correction that will give you certainly, you know, another uncertainty on the location of this line. So that's why, I mean, it's nice, but you should always, you know, take this numerical value with a grain of salt, and certainly they are not super precise numbers as people claim, you know, when they are showing you some computation to free loop or four loops, etc. of this. So I think it's just an heuristic argument. It kind of makes sense. You get some numbers that are nice numbers, but you shouldn't pay too much attention with a very precise determination of those numbers.
It is done on the assumption that nothing in between happens, which is not obvious at all, right?
Not nothing in between.
Something else happens.
Right. And also, you don't know exactly what is happening at the Planck scale. Right? That's the biggest uncertainty.
Maybe something happened long before Planck scale.
But I mean, that, yes, sure, of course. But the question was, you know, do you need something else before?
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
And just by looking at the X potential, it doesn't seem that you need to know. You don't need to introduce anything. Okay, good. So that was the first, you know, quantum correction, let's say, to one particular coupling of the X, right? So I was looking at the quantum correction to lambda. So now I want to discuss the quantum correction. Yeah, sorry.
And question from the beginning. What is the derivative of lambda O with respect to LMQ? What is this?
Well, it's just, I mean, you're doing with quantum field theory, so all the coupling are function of the energy. Like, you know, you know that the coupling, gauge coupling are function of the energy. Right? I mean, what is the value of the electric charge, of lambda electromagnetism? Is 1 over 137 at an energy which is close to zero. When you're doing atomic physics, you're saying that alpha is 1 over 137. But if you do electromagnetism at the scale of the Z boson, alpha is 1 over 28. So that's a renormalization due to the fact that the coupling are actually a function of the energy, that the running. So here is the same thing. You're asking what is the evolution of lambda as a function of the energy. So somehow you have to assume that this potential is the potential, the classical potential at an energy which is close to the weak scale. And I want to know how the potential will look like when I'm going to high energy.
And we can get this from Feynman diagrams.
Yeah, that's exactly the diagram that I drew before. Mm-hmm. You can compute them, and this will give you the one renormalization evolution of the properties.
Okay.
Exactly the same way that you derive, you know, the evolution of alpha by just computing some one diagram size. Mm-hmm. That's the thing that gave the Nobel Prize to Gross and Wilczek, right? In Politzer.
Yeah.
Minus sign into the QCD. Okay. There were also some Russian. I forgot the name of the Russian, but computing this beta function first. Good. So any question on this computation? I mean, at the end of the day, it's a rather simple computation, but okay, there is some interesting physical interpretation, physical meaning. Okay. So, if you are if you really want a project, you know, you can extend this computation to free loop, for loops. That's what people are doing at the moment, and try to refine those predictions. But as I say, I wouldn't trust so much those numbers anyway. So don't waste your time and think to think more interesting and more.
I think three loops are done, so four loops are still open. So
you have you can spend the rest of your life improving this one. But in the meantime, other people will discover new physics before quantum scale. You will have to redo all your computation. Okay, so now the quadratic divergence, or something which is known as a hierarchy problem. So I was discussing so far the evolution of the of the quartic interaction. So now I want to look at the correction to the X mass, to the two-point function. So here, at classical level, this is simply minus lambda b squared, right? So what is a one-loop diagram that gives you a correction to the two-point function, to the X mass? The tadpole, yes. There is a tadpole. What else? Okay, maybe we can spend some time looking a little bit at this diagram. So this diagram is proportional to the quartic interaction, so proportional to lambda. And this is one propagator of a gauge of a scalar field, so one over p squared. So when you compute this diagram, you get actually a logarithm, a quadratic divergence, d4p times 1 over p squared. And if you cut, you know, the momentum at an energy lambda, this will go like lambda squared. It's just a way to regularize this integral. You say that actually the standard model is valid up to an energy lambda, so this is the maximum energy that this particle can carry into the loop. Okay, so all the diagrams. Fermion loops, yes. Fermion loops. Like this, right? And again, this is quadratically divergent because you have two propagators of a fermion, but the propagator of a fermion is only one over p. So again, you get something that goes like lambda squared, right? Lambda squared, lambda squared. And there is at least a third diagram that you usually find in the books. Which is also quadratically divergent. There is some interaction between scalars and gauge boson.
Again, this is a kind of tadpole.
Because you have an interaction between two scalar field and two gauge field, again by the expansion of the covariant kinetic term.
You should not have erased it. Right? D mu h minus pi j n h.
Probably every time I'm writing this equation, I flip the sign, I flip the I. So don't trust this coefficient. But anyway, what is important is that it's always proportional to g. So this interaction, you know, between two scalar field and two gauge boson is coming from the square of this term. So it's only involved g squared, and there is no derivative in this case. It's proportional to g squared, 1 over p squared for the propagator. So again, you get a quadratically divergent contribution. And this diagram here is proportional to the Yukawa interaction squared. And again, I will consider only the top Yukawa in this case, which will be proportional to y top squared. Okay? So, let us try to compute explicitly those quadratically divergent contributions. That's some one-loop diagram that I can compute on the blackboard. I take my notes. Let me start with this one, maybe. So, what do you do?
So you have the, so the correction to the X mass, to the quadratic piece, is minus sign because it's a fermion loop. Okay, minus I over square root of 2 for this Yukawa interaction, squared because there are two Yukawa interactions. And then you have the momentum integral, d4k. You have this stupid normalization that depends on pi, 2 pi to the 4. And then you have to take, you know, the trace over the fermion trace, the propagator, I over, okay, now we replace the momentum by k, p slash minus m, the first propagator, second propagator, p slash minus m. And then you have to count the number of colors, right? So the color doesn't change when you're propagating, and the interaction with X is also color neutral. So at the end of the day, you simply need to count the number of colors, so which is equal to 3, let's say, for the top quark. So it will be also factor 3 for all the quark. And if you look at the contribution from the leptons, you will need to put a factor 1, because there is only one color. Okay. As I say, I will focus mostly on the top Yukawa contribution because this is the largest Yukawa. Okay. So what about this integral over the momentum? So I will go to the Euclidean space, right? So Euclidean means that you're using p squared is actually equal to minus p Euclidean squared, and d4p is, after integration over the angle, nothing depends on the angle in this case, is 2i pi squared pe dpe, right? So this is just the integration over the free angle, right? So you have three angles, so 2 pi squared is just the volume of a sphere with three angles. Okay. What about this trace? So you get a minus one. So this trace is equal to minus one for the pi square. Trace of p slash plus m squared divided by p squared minus m squared squared. Now you can expand this numerator. This trace p slash squared plus 2 m p slash plus m squared. So anyway, the integral over the momentum, something that depends only on one power, is equal to zero. So we can drop this. Now, the term in m squared, you know, will be actually finite or logarithmically divergent, no? Because this is 1 over p to the 4th times d4p, right? So this is only log divergent. So this I don't care. And at the end of the day, the term that I really matter, that I'm really interested in, is simply this piece that depends on p squared. So everything is this. In the same way here, I can neglect the mass of the top quark in the denominator. It doesn't matter. That's why it's relatively easy to do this computation with Blunt, because I'm neglecting many things, right? And p slash squared is simply actually p squared. No? Okay. P slash, you remember, is p mu gamma mu, right? So p slash squared is p mu, gamma mu. So this is one half of this anti-commutator. Because p nu is symmetric, so you can symmetrize these products of the gamma matrices,
And just by the Dirac algebra, this is just 2 eta mu nu, right? So at the end, you get that this is nothing else than p mu, maybe lower index. So this is p squared. And the trace, okay, so at the end of the day, trace of the identity, which is a factor 4, right? So this is minus 4 divided by p squared. Okay? So let us collect all the terms. Minus I dm squared is equal to, so I have a minus sign here, minus squared is plus 1, I have I squared, so it's minus 1, plus 1, and then I have an extra minus sign, okay, so it's 3 minus sign, 1, 2, 3, okay. Y top squared divided by 2. Okay. Then the integral of a phase space, let's say that it's 2 pi pi squared, right? Integral dPe, pe cubed, divided by 2 pi to the 4th. Here, and then it's 4 pi e, pi squared, and pi squared is minus the Euclidean momentum squared. Okay, so I haven't done any mistake, we should check. And we forgot this factor 3 for the color, right? And then the integral over the momentum, now the simple integral, right? So this integral over the momentum of something which is linear in the momentum. So it's, you introduce a cutoff, so the maximum value of the momentum, dPe times Pe. And this is 1/2 of lambda squared, right? Okay. Plus some term that finite that depends only in the infrared value of the momentum. Okay. So two to the 4 is 16. So these two constants. 4 here, give me a 4 in the denominator. So it should be, and then okay, pi squared, pi to the 4, so it's pi squared in the denominator. So it should be 3/4 pi squared, 1/2, so 3/8, pi squared, y top squared, lambda squared times I. Huh? So it should be the result. Times E. And that's it. Not even agree with my notes. We reference. Okay? So let us write the result here. I 3 divided by 8 pi squared y top squared lambda squared. Okay.
That's a correction.
Minus I dm squared. Okay, you can compute this diagram in a very similar way. I mean, there is no big surprises here. and you will get a result which is minus I 3 lambda divided by 8 pi squared times lambda squared. No big issue. Next thing that I want to compute is this diagram, because there is always a subtlety when you are dealing with gauge boson. To do some computation with gauge boson, you need to do the computation in a particular gauge. So you need to do gauge fixing. And here we do the computation in what is called the RC gauge. So the propagator will depend on this gauge fixing parameter psi. And we'll see whether or not, at the end of the day, your result is gauge independent. What is the dependence on the parameter psi? So any physical quantity should be independent of this gauge fixing parameter. So that's always a nice thing, you know, to check at the end of the result whether, you know, you have done any mistake. If there is a psi dependence in the physical quantity, it means that you are missing something. You screwed up your computation. Or it means that you are not computing a physical quantity, things that can be measured. So,
however, there is some problem behind, because the Zolus regularization with cutoff is not gauge invariant by itself. So, you know, in order to make these things consistency,
yes,
one should,
yes,
use another regularization.
Absolutely, yes. You're right. I mean, they should use some kind of polyvillar regularization, which is gauge invariant. Nonetheless,
what dimensional regularization?
Four dimensional regularization, yes.
But okay, maybe it's too complicated.
The problem of dimensional regularization is that you will never see a quadratic divergence.
Yeah, it manifests in another way.
Yeah, it manifests in another way, which is much more softer than what we have before. Which is a very interesting, actually, exercise, you know, how to understand this CRT problem in a dimensional regularization procedure. But maybe for another lecture.
Yeah.
And here we find another way to get a result which is gauge invariant, so psi independent, even with this cutoff regularization. So if you find a way to cancel the psi dependence, you're happy. You don't have to worry about this subtleties of the gauge invariance of the cutoff. Okay. So the diagram that I want to compute is really this one, right? I already say that here it's proportional to g squared, and actually the Feynman rules is I g squared. And now, if you put some gauge index, so let's say we look at SU2, I will neglect, so this computation, I will first neglect g prime. So we put g prime equal to zero in such a way that I only have SU2 that run into the loop, right? So you have a gauge index A, gauge index B, you have a Lorentz index mu, and a Lorentz index nu, right, for the two legs of this loop, right? So you should have something like TA, TB, and here probably with I and J for the SU2 index of SU2, IJ, eta mu nu. That's just the Feynman rules associated to this vertex. Then what is a propagator? The propagator is minus I over P squared minus M squared, the mass of the gauge boson, is eta mu nu. So that's a regular propagator. And now in the RC gauge, you have another piece that depends on this psi parameter, so P mu. P nu divided by P squared minus psi M squared, and the propagator doesn't change actually the gauge index with delta AB. Okay. So now you can really compute explicitly this diagram with minus I delta M squared is equal to I G squared TA TB. D, so momentum integral d4k 2 pi to the 4 minus I over
we switch momentum from P to K. Eta mu. Eta mu from here, and then another eta mu from the configuration. Eta mu minus 1 on the side, k nu, k squared on the side, n squared. So you see that now you have some quadratic divergence from this piece. Right? So that's very much equivalent to what we computed before, right? And there is also another quadratic divergence actually coming from this other piece of the propagator. It's k mu in the numerator and over k squared again. So it's another quadratically divergent piece. And at the end of the day, what do you get? So it's the same type of computation as before, right? So I won't do it here in detail. So you'll find that it's 3 minus psi g squared lambda squared over 64 pi squared. And here you start wondering about, you know, the meaning of those quadratic divergence, right? Because at the end of the day, the result is gauge dependent. To me, the contribution proportional to psi.
Which means it is not the end of the day.
That's not the end of the story, yeah. But you know, people always neglect that. I mean, you open all the books, you know, that are discussing this quadratic divergence, they show those three diagrams. And they always give you the result for psi equals zero. They stop that. They don't comment it.
So they know the answer.
You know the answer, yes, of course. So this means that we are still missing one contribution to this computation to cancel this gauge dependence. Okay, I mean, it could be that, as you said, you know, the cutoff regularization is not gauge invariant, so maybe there is some subtlety. But actually, this is not the answer. There is another diagram that you don't find in the books.
We don't find in psi equal to zero that corresponds to Landau gauge, right?
Yeah, I never remember. Psi equal zero, psi equal one, psi equal infinity.
Psi equal Feynman gauge.
Psi is zero, then you get transverse propagator.
It's transverse propagator, then it's Landau gauge.
It's Landau gauge.
Yes, okay.
Psi equal to 1 corresponds to 2
psi.
Psi
is 1 pi numbers.
Yeah. Yeah, but never remember those names. Okay, anyway, you should find a way to cancel this psi dependence. Right? And it means that we need to look at another diagram, which is usually not shown in the books or in the reviews article or in the talks. So what is this extra contribution? So first of all, you could think, you know, about ghost. You know, you're doing with gauge theory, one loop computation with gauge theory, so maybe there is a ghost, or there is a Fadeev Popov nonsense, we call it in Russia. So you can open, you know, I don't know, Peskin and Schroeder, look at the Feynman rule for the ghost, try to work out, I mean, look at the diagram that involves a ghost, and you won't find any diagram that involves a quadratic divergent contribution. So the ghosts are not the answer. The answer are actually the ghost on boson. When you are computing, you know, an RC gauge, you have to include the gauge boson, but you also have to keep track of the ghost on boson. It's only in the unitary gauge that the ghostons are eaten and become the longitudinal component of the gauge boson. So this means that if you are working in an RC gauge, you have to look also at diagrams that could involve the ghoston boson. And indeed, there is an extra contribution which is quadratically divergent.
Took me a while to find it. It is there.
I don't know, actually, if you do this computation with MatGraph, I don't know if MatGraph will show you this diagram or not.
MatGraph? At what level?
Yeah, I think now MatGraph, no, ANC at NLO, whatever it's called, will give you some one computation. So I don't know.
For cross-sections, but not for propagations.
So there is this extra diagrams. This is the W. So now I don't know how to draw the line of the Boltzmann boson, maybe a double line of a dotted index. Right? So it's the X, and then a Boltzmann boson that also carry a gauge index, right? The WA, the Boltzmann boson. And in this case, indeed, there is again a vertex with one gauge boson, and it's a one X and one Boltzmann boson, which is again coming from the expansion of this covariant kinetic term, and this involves one derivative, right? One gauge boson, two scalar fields, so one derivative. So this Feynman rules here involve one power of the momentum. This is I J over 2, J nu, and it should be delta AB, where A are the gauge index. So here and here again. And the propagator, the propagator of the Boltzmann is simply one of the k squared, minus xi m w. So again, if you count the momentum, you have G from K. You have two propagators that goes like one over k squared, right? So one over k squared. But you have two interactions that now are proportional to the momentum. This k squared. So again, this is giving you a contribution which is what it is here. And at the end of the day, you can compute this diagram. I think I gave you all the information that you need. You have the propagator, so you can really do this computation. And you find that minus delta m squared is equal to minus 5, 3, g squared, lambda squared, and 64 pi squared, and psi. And that's exactly what you need, actually, to cancel this gauge contribution. So there is indeed a cancellation. And the finite result, when you're summing these four diagrams, is gauge invariant. Now you should be confident that what you are computing is actually a physical problem.
More precisely, it's not gauge invariant, it's gauge independent.
Gauge independent.
What you prove is that it's gauge independent. In order to prove that it's gauge invariant, is a bit more.
Yes.
And here you might face a problem with the lambda graph.
You're probably right. Anyway, so.
But it's very good that it's gauge independent.
The first check that you're not doing any stupid mistakes.
Exactly.
So. We can now collect the final expression and discuss the meaning, the physical meaning of this result. So you get at the end of the day, okay, so you know that all of these copies, are related to the mass, right? So the mass of the X is 2 lambda V squared, the mass of the top is y top and v divided by square root of 2. The mass of the w, 1/4 g squared v squared. So you can replace the coupling that were appearing in this expression as a function of the mass. And you get that delta mh squared is 3 lambda squared divided by 16 pi squared v squared. So if you do in the limit of g prime goes to 0, you will find 3 mw squared plus mh squared minus 4 m top squared. And if you reintroduce g prime, which is different than 0, you will find actually that this 3 mw is actually equal to 2 times mw squared plus md squared. So that's the final result. Okay, so if you put some numbers, you will find something, I think, like 120 GeV squared times lambda divided by 1 TeV squared. That's the numerical expression of this. So this means that, you know, if you push the cutoff at energies which are much above the TeV, then you will get a contribution to the X mass, correction to the X mass, which is much larger than the three-level contribution that you...
Christophe, I'm sorry that I interrupt you, because I also faced with this once. You see, your contribution to mTOP, please divide is 16 by 4. It will be 3 over 4.
Yeah.
But the answer you get was 3 over 8 for the top quark contribution. So I also faced with this once. You see, there is your answer.
Yeah,
3 over 8, but here it will be 3 over 4.
Yes. I mean, we have to be careful now. But what I mean by m squared, so that's the physical mass for real scalar fields. So that means minus 1 half mh squared and h squared.
Yes, okay.
I was looking, you know, at the contribution of the quadratic term. So it was m squared. H squared, right?
Yes.
So there is a factor 1 half difference.
Yeah, that is.
That's probably the answer.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. We can check later that everything should be consistent. So the relative factor.
That is exactly the answer, right, which I wanted to have.
Can I ask a global question?
Yes.
You see, I come from the Bogoliubov School of Theoretical Physics.
Yes.
I've been taught that the present-day quantum field theory cannot calculate masses of elementary particles. They are input parameters that are taken from the experiment.
Yes.
So what we can calculate the mass of the radar. And it should be normalized so that as the physical mass of the particle, it's equal to zero. And if you calculate, in fact, you calculate the mass of the radar. The contribution that does not depend on the momentum. And if we subtract it as the physical mass of the particle, everything disappears. There's nothing to talk about. So I do not see the problem. So in my opinion, so it is, it was a rigorous approach. I know that we know that the divergence has appeared as a result of multiplying distributions with coinciding singularities.
Yeah.
And we have to, these are functionals, and we can consider them on a subspace of basic functions where they really exist. Then we can extend them, and the extension should be fixed by physical arguments. So that the mass is exactly the observable mass. So how these two points of view can be reconciled, let's put it so.
Yeah, I mean, it's always, I mean, the usual question, what is really the meaning of quadratic divergence in quantum field theory? Indeed, if you do some dimensional regularization, you throw away any momentum dependence or whatever. Everything which is not log divergence, you throw away in dim rack, right? So strictly speaking, I think if you are really within the standard model alone, you shouldn't observe any quadratic divergence. So there is not, those numbers have no meaning in the standard model. Nonetheless, they acquire meaning, you know, as soon as you couple the standard model degrees of freedom to new particles. So for instance, if you do this computation in the gut theory where you have new physical particles, let's say at the gut scale, you couple to the X, and then that's exactly what you will obtain. You will obtain the correction to the X mass, which is proportional to the mass of this gut particle. So here you should really see lambda as, let's say, a threshold for new particles that exist that will couple to X. So as soon as X is coupled to AV new degrees of freedom, it will acquire, it will receive a contribution to its mass, which is proportional at one loop level to the mass of this AV particle. Strictly speaking, there is no hierarchy problem in the standard model because there is a single scale. So the hierarchy problem is really how to maintain a separation of scale at the quantum level. So in the standard model, there is no LD scale, so there is nothing to destabilize the weak scale. As soon as you introduce new particle, new AV particle, new AV degrees of freedom, you introduce a coupling to the X, and then this new particle will give a contribution to the mass of the X, which is proportional to the mass.
In effect, Christopher, if you do computation in dimensional realization, you exactly get this interpretation, what you are saying right now.
You have a threshold correction
here,
which is indeed proportional to the AV mass.
And in standard model, is a normalizable theory. You can put into renormalized quantities everything.
Yes.
And then the problem, the essential problem,
is
exactly
like this. In a threshold correction.
But that computation, that is my guess, my way of feeling of this. That is indication of some hint, you know, that something is well, you know, such a strong behavior on a cutoff, which is strictly speaking not there. But once you see it, you started to worry what's going on. And
of course, if you repeat the same kind of computation for fermions, you know, you wouldn't see any quadratic divergence.
So I think we should keep in mind an extension of the standard model, and then this computation makes sense. Otherwise, it really cancels.
There is no meaning within the standard model, there is no meaning. Of course, I mean, we know that you need to add something to the standard model for various reasons. So quantum gravity, so there is a question whether, you know, in any quantum gravity theory, you are sure to end up with this quadratic divergence or not. Because you have new degrees of freedom, but maybe, you know, the behavior of this new 80 degrees of freedom is such a way that they don't couple to the X, or I don't know, for some reason, they have some form factors or anything that cancels this quadratic divergence. I don't know. There is no clear answer to this question at the moment. I think people have tried, you know, in any string Fano model, and they found something which is equivalent to this quadratic divergence. So what I wanted to say now is simply that you need to find a solution, let's say, to make some numbers natural. So what do we mean by natural theory? So it simply means that all the quantum correction, in particular delta mh, should remain smaller than the classical value that you put by that. So that's the definition of natural. So it means that you really start with a potential with numbers that you match at tree level to the experimental value, and you try to ask yourself, you know, whether the quantum correction give you large deviation from this tree level expression. If not, you know, if you satisfy this equation, then you say that the tree level description is a good theory where you can understand really what is going on. You don't need to adjust all the different parameters for the quantum correction to cancel with each other and end up with to agree with what has been measured. Okay. So strictly speaking, okay, if you want to satisfy this equation, you see that you need to introduce new physics beyond the standard model at a scale, let's say, below 1 TeV. If you push the cutoff, let's say, to 10 TeV already, you need really to adjust, you know, the tree-level contribution together with this one-loop correction to a level which is more than 1%. So you need really to tune those two quantities with each other in such a way that you get two large numbers, they almost cancel with each other, and end up with a number which is 100 times smaller and agree with the experimental value. So it really means that you need to tune, you know, two quantities that are a priori totally independent, right? contribution which is here coming from the UV physics and the contribution of the infrared contribution, the three-level contribution. So it's not an inconsistency, just seems really weird that you need to adjust different quantities that have nothing to do with each other. So if you are happy, you know, of accident in nature, then you can live with fine-tuning. If you, you know, want to really understand, then it means that probably you need to find an explanation why those two independent quantities are related to each other and almost cancel, and leave a small numbers, a number which is much smaller than the two quantities, and a smaller number that agrees with what is measured experimentally. So at this level is really, I mean, a matter of principle, a matter of taste. But there is no theoretical inconsistency for fine-tuning. Just that it's unlikely. It means that most likely you don't have the right explanation. So what I want to discuss in the rest of the lecture is actually some modification of the standard model that exactly cancels this quadratically divergent contribution to the X mass. So you need to add new degrees of freedom, new symmetries, new forces, new dynamics to make the X mass insensitive to the UV physics, to what is happening at high energy. So we say usually when you are looking at this expression, we say that the X mass is UV sensitive. Right? The X mass receives a large contribution which is coming from high energy, from the UV sector. The standard model. So you want to make the X mass UV insensitive. You want to cancel this quadratic divergence. So maybe I can sketch maybe some possibilities, you know, to cancel this quadratic divergence, and that will correspond to the various type of model of physics beyond the standard model. So what do you do? What do you have at your disposal to cancel those quadratic divergence? There is at least a few tricks that you can play with. The first one is just a field theory, so it's called the Goldstone theorem again. So the Goldstone theorem is telling you that every time you have a spontaneously broken global symmetry, you expect a massless boson in the spectrum. So if you have a global symmetry which is spontaneously broken, this implies a massless Goldstone boson. Massless Goldstone boson in the spectrum. So maybe, you know, at the end of the day, you want to see the X really as a Goldstone boson. So maybe you need to imagine that there is larger global symmetry which are spontaneously broken that produce more than the free Goldstone boson that we have already identified that becomes the longitudinal component of the W of the Z. Maybe there will be a fourth Goldstone boson that you want to identify with the X boson. Okay, this global symmetry won't be totally exact symmetry, so the Goldstone boson becomes pseudo-Goldstone boson in such a way that the correction to the mass will be, in this case, proportional to the symmetry breaking factor of the symmetry. Right? So it will be proportional, let's say, to the gauge coupling squared or whatever. But at least there will be, you know, some loop suppression factor. So here it's really the breaking parameter of this global symmetry. So if this global symmetry is an almost exact symmetry, this breaking parameter will be small. And then you have a way to protect the mass of the X boson.
In a way, like mass of ion is much smaller than proton mass.
Absolutely. So that's, for instance, what is happening in QCD. In QCD, you understand why the mass of the pion, which are 100 MeV, is much smaller than lambda QCD, which is of the order of 1 GeV. Mass of the proton. So why mass of the pion, which is again a scalar field, right? I mean, it's a scalar field. So why the mass of the boson is not, and the mass of the pion is not proportional to lambda squared? Simply because it's a boson boson. And actually, you can even use this argument, you know, for instance, compute the mass difference between the charged pion and the neutral pion. And you will see that this is exactly proportional to QED, to the QED coupling that breaks actually the symmetry. Right? So it will be proportional to alpha electromagnetism divided by 4 pi times lambda QCD, something like QCD squared. I don't remember who proved this kind of relation. I can give you a reference. So the question is whether you want to identify the X as a Goldstone boson.
Was it not done by Wenger in his chiral perturbation theory? Or
before? Somebody else. I mean, I don't think Wenger was the first to really look at this relation. The only issue is that usually when you're dealing with Goldstone boson, has some, usually has only some non-derivative coupling. Because, you know, Goldstone boson means actually that there is a non-linear symmetry, so the Goldstone boson, you know, G transforms as G plus a constant. So for the theory to be invariant under this kind of shift symmetry, you know, the Goldstone need to couple derivatively. Then clearly, if it only enters via derivative, then you are totally insensitive to this constant shift. But you cannot have a non-derivative coupling. The non-derivative coupling will be a breaking of this, of the shift symmetry. The problem, and that's really the difficulty, is that the X apparently has some sizable non-derivative coupling, in particular the Torp-Yukawa coupling, which is a number for the one. So all the difficulty really is to be able to generate the large Torp-Yukawa coupling and still be consistent somehow with this shift symmetry. Okay, the other trick that you can use, that you can play with, is again quantum mechanics. Thing that you insisted upon last time, that a particle of spin S has 2S plus 1 degrees of polarization, degrees of freedom. With the only exception of a particle which is moving at the speed of light. As we have understood yesterday, the photon has only two polarizations and not three because it's propagating at the speed of light. So there is always a possibility to distinguish the longitudinal polarization from the transverse one. There is a physical meaning to these different polarizations. That's only possible if the particle is moving at the speed of light, namely if the particle is massless. But the converse is true also. If a particle of spin S has less than 2s plus 1 degrees of polarization, then necessarily it is moving at the speed of light, namely it remains massless. So that's exactly what is protecting some of the mass of a spin 1. So why the photon doesn't receive quantum correction to its mass? Because you are always been able to decouple the longitudinal polarization, so you end up with two transverse polarizations. And if you have only two polarizations, there is no way that the particle can acquire mass. And the same is also true for the spin 1 half. Right? So spin 1, you have gauge invariance, right? So gauge invariance is what is decoupling actually the longitudinal polarization, so gauge invariance ensure that the longitudinal polarization is not physical. And then automatically, the mass of the photon remains equal to zero at the quantum level. So you can give a mass to the gauge boson only if you break gauge invariance. So the correction, the quantum correction to the mass of the gauge boson will be proportional to the parameter that breaks gauge invariance. If you send this parameter to zero, then the mass of the gauge boson will remain zero. And the same is true for the spin 1 half particle. So spin 1 half particle, you have chiral symmetry. So chiral symmetry is just telling you that left and right chirality are different. So this means that in this case, you have only one chirality. So if you spin 1 half, which is chiral, there is only one chirality. So 1 is less than 2. So this means that as long as chiral symmetry is not broken, the quantum correction to the mass will remain zero. A chiral fermion can only have a massless, a vanishing mass. If you have only a left-handed electron, you cannot give a mass to the left-handed electron. You need a right-handed and left-handed electron and a breaking of chiral symmetry to generate a mass to the fermions. So that's exactly what, you know, what is happening. If you compute the correction to the mass of the electron, it will be proportional to the mass of the electron. So the chiral series, there is a symmetry that protects the quantum correction. It's totally different compared to this expression, right? So here, you have a correction which is proportional to the mass. So if the mass is small, the quantum correction will be small. Here, this is not the case, right? Even if you start with a vanishing mass of the Higgs boson, you will generate a large mass of the Higgs boson. Simply because there is no symmetry that protects the mass. There is no enhanced symmetry. You know, when you send the mass of the Higgs boson to zero, you are not increasing the symmetry of the standard model. So that's really the meaning of naturalness in the sense of Torf. So a theory is natural, or a parameter is natural, so alpha, whatever parameter is natural if and only if you have an enlargement, you have an increase of the symmetry, so the symmetry enlarge when the parameter goes to zero, when this parameter goes to zero. So this is the case for the fermion. If you send the mass of the electron to zero, the theory becomes chiral. But this is not the case for the Higgs boson. If you send the mass of the Higgs to zero, you don't get any extra symmetry. Nonetheless, there is a way. Okay, now you have spin 1, spin 1 half, so what about spin 0? Well, the problem with spin 0 is that you have only 1 degree of freedom, right? So if you get rid of it, you have nothing left. So you cannot directly use a spin trick to protect the mass of the spin 0. Nonetheless, you can use a spin trick if you know you have new symmetry that relates particles of different spin. So for instance, you could imagine a symmetry that will relate a spin 1 half particle to a spin 0 particle. That's what is called supersymmetry. So supersymmetry is actually giving a meaning to the chirality of a spin 0 particle. So in the MSSN, in the minimal supersymmetric standard model, you are talking, for instance, about the stop right and the stop left. Stop left and stop right. So there are two scalar fields. And nonetheless, we are associating a meaning of a chirality to a scalar field, to a spin zero particle. And what is this meaning? It simply means that the stop left by supersymmetry is related to the top left. And the stop right is related by supersymmetry to the top right. So we are giving the chirality of the scalar inherit the chirality of the fermion that is it is associated with by supersymmetry. And since the mass of this guy is protected by chiral symmetry, then you are now giving a chiral protection to the mass of the spin zero. You could also imagine connecting a spin zero particle to a spin one particle in 4D. So do you know such a symmetry that will relate a spin zero particle to a spin one particle? Don't transformation symmetry that will mix the scalar with the vector. No? Roger? Hmm? One guess, and then we can conclude and go for lunch.
Yes.
Well, simply Lorentz transformation in higher dimension. If you do a five-dimensional Lorentz transformation, you start with a vector in five dimensions. It will have some component along the four dimension. It will have a component along the extra dimension, A5. And the Lorentz transformation is simply mixing A mu and A5, right? So if you have Lorentz transformation, if you have 5D, then you can see the spin zero as a component of a gauge field along an extra dimension. This is a scalar field from the four-dimensional point of view. And this scalar field will transform in a vector with a spin in a spin one field viewed from the four-dimensional point of view again, simply by Lorentz transformation. So in this case, you can really, you know, protect the mass of the spin zero component simply by gauge invariance. So again, this quantum mechanics that will protect the quantum correction to this A5 component of the gauge. Okay, so we will discuss this this class of model in the remaining lectures.
Yeah.
Okay.
So maybe we'll stop at this point, because we're already quite out of time for lunch. But if you have some very important and urgent question, you can ask. Otherwise, just, you know, attack the lecturer and ask him questions directly. Okay.
Okay.
Thanks.